This week, we discuss test drive etiquette at the dealership, whether dash cams can save you money on your insurance, and can a car be de-recalled? Next on Talking Cars. Hi, and welcome back. I'm Mike Quincy.
I'm Keith Barry.
And I'm Jennifer Stockberger.
Thanks again for joining us on your favorite podcast, as well as mine. And of course, as always, we have a very special Talking Cars because it's all questions and all answers. Luckily, we've got some awesome ones coming up for you. So please keep the questions coming. Text, video, Morse code. Send them all to TalkingCars@iCloud.com. That's TalkingCars@iCloud.com. Leading off is a video question. This is Alex from Montreal.
Hi, Talking Cars. I've got a question about car shopping etiquette. At what point is it okay to go into a dealer and ask to test drive a car? Do I need to be ready to buy the car within weeks? What if I'm only interested in buying within the next couple of years? Also, should I call in advance and tell them I'm interested in a certain model and I'd like to test drive it? Or do I just show up? Thanks a lot for the info. Ciao.
Oh, Alex, so polite. You know, Canadians, maybe. So car buying etiquette. Jen, does Alex, you know, hit on a few good points here?
He does, but, you know, if there's one thing we know at Consumer Reports, it's the car buying process. I think we've shared many times that all of our actual formal test cars, we purchase at dealers, and we purchase anonymously. So my quick Google was that the average person buys between six and 10 cars over their lifetime. There are some of us at Consumer Reports Auto Test that are doing 5 a year. So we have a lot of experience. And because we're doing it anonymously, we get to go through both the good and the bad of the buying experience. And for Alex, I would say, Alex, you're being a little too nice, quite frankly. You're spending a lot of money with this dealer, and a good dealer shouldn't be concerned at all of how many test drives you want to do. I would be far more concerned about you feeling like you're wasting your own time than theirs. So certainly narrow down your choices as best you can. But if you need to get in 25 vehicles to choose the one that's right for you, gosh darn it, get in 25 vehicles, and a good dealer should accommodate you and be very willing. And if they're not, move on. Move to a different salesperson. Move to a different dealership. You're very nice, Alex.
And obviously, right now, at this particular moment in time, don't get into 25 cars with 25 people.
Right.
That's a very bad idea. But in the future, Alex, I feel you. I'm the sort of person who, when I get the wrong meal at a restaurant, I apologize. I'm so sorry. I think you gave me, I'm sorry. But here's the thing, and you have to get over this, because the dealer is not your friend. They're not going to be your friend. As nice as they are to you, you are to them a lead. You are someone who walks in, and it is that salesperson's opportunity to make a sale. If they don't make a sale to you, they're going to have to find something to get out of you. And in a lot of cases, this is personal information. This is before you sign, you know, before you get to drive the vehicle. And at least this is in the way that it works in the United States. You often have to share some information. You have to give a phone number, they'll check to make sure you're insured, you have a license, things like that. But also, that gives a name, address, phone number, email for that dealer to contact you when they're having a slow day. And when that salesperson hasn't had someone like you walking in, their manager is going to say, "Why aren't you selling any cars?" And they're going to have to go through their lead book and call or email. And a lot of this is automated as well. So just be prepared. Maybe make a separate email that you only use. Get a Google Voice number. Get that distance between you and the dealer. And the more you remember that, the more you realize that it's a sales interaction. It's a business interaction.
Great question. Always get information. Always get questions on car buying, and good luck with it, Alex. And let us know how it works out. So, how cool is this? We have another video question. This time, it's Joe from New Jersey.
Hi, Consumer Reports Talking Cars. I just installed my first dash cam, and I was wondering what your thoughts are relative to dash cams And if they're a benefit from a standpoint of driver safety, or if they might impact insurance rates, and also if there's any talk from the auto manufacturers that they might make the dash cam a standard part of their vehicle offering, or at least included in the options packages. Thank you.
So dash cams, insurance rates, futures, this is going to be in cars going forward. Keith, what is your advice for Joe?
Yeah, so at least in the United States, there aren't any insurers that give discounts for having a dash cam. That is the case in some other countries, but it's not the case here. So if you Google it, you might find something in English, and then you start to realize there are too many U's in the words. but in the United States, they don't allow it yet. Dash cams are very useful. They are useful for recording interactions with the police. They are useful for hit and runs. If your car is parked, there is some which can automatically record. And, you know, you walk out and your side view mirror has been knocked off, and you could just go to your dash cam and see the plate of the city plow that did it, in my case.
They should have mailbox cams here in the Northeast.
Yeah, right. Exactly. On Halloween, who put the silly string in your, et cetera. And they're also useful if there is a crash to send to an insurance company and show that someone indeed cut you off, or somebody else did something wrong in the crash. They're helpful in providing a witness statement if you witness a crash and you want to help out somebody else. But they're not going to lower your monthly insurance premium. What are called these usage-based insurances. We have a lot online about those. And the first one that came out and kind of got a lot of traction was Progressive Snapshot. Now there are a bunch of others from all the major insurers. They're legal in most states. And the way that they work is that you plug in a little tiny computing device into your car's data port. And it shares information on how fast you drive, how abruptly you stop, how hard you accelerate, how many miles you drive with your insurance company. This year, we've heard from a lot of readers who have got these because they're driving less than they were in other years, and they want to reflect that with a premium discount. The only issue is... Well, there are actually two issues. The first issue is sometimes people drive a lot more and a lot harder than they think they do. And you might see your premiums go up. The other thing is that you're sharing your personal information of everywhere you go, of how you drive. You're sharing a lot of information with your insurance company. And, we have some information on the privacy concerns on CR.org. You might want to check out, but just keep that in mind. There's always, just like when you're giving your email address to a dealer, there's always a catch, and suddenly you are the product when something is free or saving money.
And one couple things I'll add is that you have to make sure that your camera is not mounted on a place on your windshield that might affect your visibility. Definitely check your local and state laws, because some have restrictions about putting anything on your windshield. So you better check that out. And Consumer Reports latest story about this, you could expect to pay between about $50 and $200 to get one of these. We have a great story, as Keith mentioned, on consumerreports.org. And one thing also is that Tesla and BMW actually offer built-in surveillance cameras on some of their models. So regarding the future, it'll be interesting to see if other car companies, follow their lead and go forward with this. Yep. Next up is a question from Will. I recently got an email from CARFAX telling me there's a recall on my 2015 Honda Accord. However, when I looked the recall up on NHTSA's website, and that's the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, I cannot find anything associated with my VIN, vehicle identification number. The only website that says there's a recall on my car is CARFAX. Why the inconsistency? Now, Keith Berry, you've probably written more about recalls than anyone in Consumer Reports history. So if you can, what advice do you have for Will?
Sure. So I actually reached out to Will and found out some more information about his car. And the key here is that his car was mostly registered in Arizona and California. The specific recall is one that is related to rust. And Arizona and California are not states where rust is a problem. And often manufacturers will geographically limit if a car has ever been registered or owned or sold in various states that are part of the Rust Belt, essentially, they'll limit the recall to those states. Now, if your car has rust, if you, you know, if you have a cabin in somewhere or family, and you go, your car's registered in Florida, but you half of the year you keep it in Ohio, you can call the manufacturer, and sometimes they'll, on a case by case basis, decide whether the car has a recall. What happened here is this car was actually de-recalled. I called Honda. Will shared his VIN with me, and I called Honda. And there's actually there are phone numbers you can call for almost every manufacturer, and they're usually printed on the recall. Sometimes they're wrong. That's something that I found is actually the case pretty often. So if you just get like a weird busy signal or something, just Google the name of the manufacturer and customer service and get in contact with them, because sometimes those numbers go to like a dry cleaner who gets 5,000 phone calls when we publish. It happened like 2 weeks ago that a manufacturer changed their phone number and someone else got it. Anyhow, Honda, someone very nice at Honda told me that this car, they actually kind of culled some cars that were part of this particular recall. They narrowed it down. They found out, and car manufacturers can do this because they keep incredible data on the parts that go into every car at the manufacturing process. So they can look at a list of every single alternator that went into every single car, and they can find out the days of the wrong alternators being installed, and they can go to the manufacturer of the alternator and find out what day someone had a bad day at the factory and let the bad ones through, and they can narrow it down. We've seen recalls with one car, six cars, five cars. In this case, it's a larger recall, but they made it a little smaller because they found out that certain cars, those ones that aren't necessarily in the Rust Belt, are not included. So the good news is, Will, the next time your car's at the mechanic, you can mention it. Next time it's at the dealer, you can mention it and say, hey, can you just take a look at this? But there is no recall in your car. Your car has been de-recalled.
Keith, as always, great work on recalls. So before we move on, we just wanted to take a moment to let you know about the Talking Cars donation program. If you're not aware, Consumer Reports is a nonprofit organization, so all the work we do is funded by memberships as well as donations. If you're able to give, it really does help us to keep doing the work we do, including this show. You can find more information at cr.org/givetalkingcars. So with housekeeping out of the way, we've got a question now. This is Jeremy from Washington, D.C. And Jeremy writes, I recently needed a truck with towing capacity beyond that of my Silverado's 5,500 pounds, so I went online to start looking around. I was immediately taken aback by the price of both new and used pickups, and the new ones seemed to only be available in higher trims. Is this pricing due to COVID closures and resulting stock shortages? So, Jen, you disclosed that you recently purchased a truck with your husband. So what was your experience like?
Yeah, so I think we too had a little bit of sticker shock. And I think, and we purchased in early COVID, April timeframe. So we thought, maybe we would be seeing some benefit from that. We really didn't. We ended up with an F-150 around just over $40,000, a lot of money. So I think what has happened is, long gone are the years when pickup trucks were just work trucks. So what has happened is, one, demand is very high, super popular vehicles. And, economics said when demand is high, prices stay high. And they do. The other thing is that the work truck still exists. So you have these bare bones, regular cab, long bed trucks that are used by contractors, etc. And then you have your, super high-end Denali, I think of some of those very plush trim levels that are, nobody's ever going to put a log or concrete in the back. They're truly just a commuter car. So what happens is you often see the advertised price, and it's real, for the work truck. So I just did, we were talking about Jeremy was talking about a Silverado. So if you run that, base cab, long bed WT trim for the Silverado right now, 2021, $30,595.
And that's like no options, right?
No options. The minute you do anything, so for example, you make that a crew cab short bed, one of the most popular body configurations, the price immediately goes up to $36,510. You haven't done anything else. If you then make it four-wheel drive versus two-wheel drive, it goes up to $39,810. You have not picked an option. You have not added safety features. You have not added amenities. So I think with trucks, that sticker shock comes from expecting $30,000 and ending up at $40,000, which is what we just went through. And don't be surprised. You make it a diesel, you're looking at $50,000 if you're looking for towability. So I don't know if you guys see that, but my advice would be don't overtruck yourself. Don't overtruck it so far that you walk yourself right up into a super expensive truck. They're expensive enough. So really think about what your needs are.
I mean, Keith, we've seen, you know, the price of luxury cars always traditionally in an automotive history standpoint always be, you know, really expensive. But trucks these days, I mean, you could spend, you know, $60,000-$70,000 on a truck. Are trucks now like the new luxury car?
Trucks are the new luxury car. And you look at it, and I think with gas prices low, trucks are a bit of a status symbol. It's a different kind of status symbol. It's you can have that comfort, but still look like it's for work. It doesn't look like, you know, you don't pull up to someone's house in a pickup truck and they think, oh, fancy. You know, you don't get made fun of for for a truck in certain circles. But you can still have those really nice things. And a lot of that is just pure profit for these manufacturers. And the manufacturers know that things are changing. They know that we're heading towards electrification. They know that that things are going to be different, that there's going to be automation, that they have to invest a lot of money in new powertrains, new technology. And they are, what's the something while the sun shines or something while striking while the iron's hot, making hay while the sun shines. Jen, you'd know about that. Making hay while the sun shines.
Yes.
Because people, there's this craze for these luxury pickup trucks, and anything over that kind of middle number that Jen mentioned, as soon as you get the leather, the heated steering wheels, the this, the that, they essentially have first-class airline seats in some of these now. A lot of that is just profit for the automakers that they can then hopefully plow into new technologies. But if all you need to do is plow, get that base truck. See how I turn it around there. All right.
Jeremy, you know, like we say to everybody, let us know how it works out. Hope you get a great truck. So next question up is Ross. My father's name was Ross. So Ross writes, for quite some time, beginning with the late 1970s Chevrolet El Camino, I've noticed automakers frequently designing their cars with taillights in the rear bumper. Why would anyone design a car where fragile parts like this are mounted in one place where the car is designed to take small impacts? Now, I'm sure super producer Dave Abrams could answer this, but is this the first time we've had a podcast question where an El Camino has been brought up? I mean, holy cow. Keith, I know you have some opinions about this and some experiences with sort of cars with wacky taillights.
Yeah, I've always noticed these, you know, I was sort of coming of age when the G-body was popular, late, you know, first the A-body, then the G-body. And that was that El Camino, that was the Malibu wagon. One of my neighbors has a Cutlass Cruiser G-body wagon kind of parked out behind his house. And the first thing when I look at those is where are the taillights? And they're just kind of in the bumper. And not only is it, you know, something which is going to be more expensive to fix, but they're also really hard to see. At the other end of that spectrum, something which I love is in the mid-90s, there was this idea of vehicles. I think it started with the Volvo 850, and we had one when I was growing up with the taillights that kind of stretched the whole length of the back of the vehicle, and it's for better visibility. It's especially important now that people are up in higher cars that they can see those taillights kind of in their face as opposed to down at the bumper. Land Rover did the same thing with the Discovery. They kind of changed it from way down to going all along the tail. But Jen, You're the one who actually talks like safety and with lighting designers, right?
Yeah. And what it really is this balance, and we hear it from the manufacturers. I'm not, you know, putting my own opinion, but of styling versus really practicality. You know, it's funny, when we started testing headlights in 2004, a lot of the lighting engineers said, oh my gosh, it will be so great. You've now given us a voice, because they were often battling against the stylists and they had no voice to say, hey, you can make that look really cool, that headlight or whatever. But guess what? When you get tested in Consumer Reports tests, it's not going to shine. It's not going to illuminate very well. And you're going to often see poorer scores for those. So it was this balance, this back and forth, and we gave them a voice. So without a countermeasure, the stylist may win. And they often do. And in this case, it's very interesting to listen to you, Keith, and to listen to this question, because people should think a little deeper. As you're buying a car, new or used, walk around a little bit. See where these areas could be that could be prone. If I have even a mild fender bender, what's going to get broken here in addition to it just being the bumper? We're seeing it a little bit with where these advanced driving assist system sensors are. Where are those sensors? Am I going to be looking at replacement, recalibration, just for a bump or a ding? And where you drive may make a difference in the car you get based on those questions and that walk around.
Excellent. Great answers, you guys. Thanks so much. Finally, wrapping up this all question episode, this is Pete from Virginia Beach, Virginia, who asks, longtime member of CR and listener of the podcast, you guys rock. Especially Jennifer. I'm surprised she isn't in a back brace carrying this show for you guys. We have a family of four with two teenage drivers. I drive a Tesla Model 3, and we just bought a Model Y for my wife, and we have a Honda CR-V for the kids. However, my wife doesn't like the Model Y at all and has swapped cars with our son, who is now a 16-year-old driving around in a Tesla. So the plan is to sell the Model 3 and get a vehicle better suited to our teens. My wife is adamant it not be too small and should have all the best safety features. I want to make sure it has good responsiveness and acceleration. Our budget is up to $30,000. What should we consider? So, Jen, I'm sorry, or should I say MVP? you've done a lot of work with cars for teen drivers, so you're up first.
Yeah. So first, thank you so much, Pete. I mean, all these guys are great. I don't have to carry anything, but I do love the positive feedback. There's probably as many questions or comments that say, geez, that Jennifer really doesn't have a lot to say, does she? But anyway, I really appreciate it. So yes, so to answer your question, we have two great lists. This year, we actually collaborated with the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety to create both best new and used cars for young drivers. They're really great cars for anybody, but we specifically focused on young drivers. And your concerns are valid. You know, young drivers, no matter how good they are, there's some judgment and some experience that needs to be developed. And to do that in a Tesla Model Y is probably a little bit of a concern. You know, that car goes 4.7 seconds, 0 to 60. It's just begging for too much, you know, be it in a curve or somewhere, too much capability for a young driver, quite frankly. And as much as you want good acceleration and response, all good things, you don't want too much. It's not only a risk to your young driver, it's a risk to others, and it's a risk to the car, and probably very expensive for your teen to develop that experience in a Tesla Model Y. So with that said, I looked at those two lists that we have worked on, and my pick was a Mazda CX-5. You know, obviously your family enjoys sportiness, good handling, and I think that the Mazda CX-5 fits that bill. Also has things we consider on that list. Great reliability, great owner satisfaction. People who own it love it. And probably a car that after his experience in the Model Y, your son's going to be okay with driving. So that would be my pick for you. I don't know if you guys had other thoughts.
Now, Keith, you had a great reaction to this question.
I want Pete to adopt me. I just, you know, I anyhow. Yeah, so I kind of intuited something from here. I kind of got the sense that, you know, if there are Teslas involved, you're probably concerned a little about fuel economy, that sort of thing, how much gas is getting used. And a CRV is one of those like real practical cars. I'm getting a sense that Pete might work in, as like an engineer. His wife might be an engineer. They might both be engineers. And that you know, that kind of Honda buyer idea here, I'm thinking an Accord hybrid. And I'm thinking maybe a two-year-old or three-year-old Accord hybrid. Because a used car, I mean, when you have a young driver driving a car, they're going to scratch something. They're going to do something that's going to reduce the value of this vehicle in some way. Also, if they're a young driver, the insurance is going to be higher, and it's going to be higher on a new vehicle. So something that's a couple years old, but still kind of from that same generation, I would say a used Accord hybrid is going to get you great fuel economy. It's peppy. It's got that nice acceleration from the electric motor right off the line. It's tuned a little bit sportier than, say, the Camry hybrid or something like a Prius. And it's a sedan, so it's got that nice low center of gravity. I think it's a great choice. And plus, you know, if they're going to school or anything, there's a trunk that you can just throw crap in and close it, and it won't look messy. Which I just kind of intuit that's something that Pete and family might be concerned about. So that's my pick.
So I'm thinking, like, Pete has this opportunity to be the coolest dad in the world. I have two sons in my house, and I've never been the coolest dad.
Mike, but, no, I was going to say Pete would be taking that crown away from cool dad Mike Quincy.
Yeah, well, as a teenager driving a Tesla, probably thinks, oh my gosh, I've hit the lottery. Teslas and our Fisker, which I believe Anatoly the Great has B-roll of that's showing right now, we're like one of the few cars that my oldest son and his friends thought were cool. So to think you're a teenage driver driving a Tesla would be, you know, awesome. I would say to Pete's wife, I wouldn't worry so much about the size. And Jen, you know this is true. Small cars can be very safe. The crash test results can be good relative to the class, as we like to say. So I wouldn't get too hung up on that. That being said, I would go with the Subaru Legacy. I like the Legacy because as standard forward collision warning, automatic emergency braking. But what really puts me over the edge with this one is the sedan profile. In other words, the visibility all around for the driver is really good. The seats are good. The controls are mostly easy. Has great reliability, good fuel economy, standard all-wheel drive. I love the Legacy. I think this is one of these cars that doesn't get as much attention as it should. And you know, you're not, you know, a total nerd driving it or anything like that. But I'm sure that Pete's kids, like, Dad, I really want to hold on to the Tesla if that's okay with you. So anyway, good luck. Let us know how that works out, certainly.
And I just want to reinforce, and I, you know, any car you get, new or used, look for all of those safety features, that automatic emergency brake. Those are the things that back up your young driver as that experience gets gained. So absolutely, new
and
or used.
Specifically, when you have a Tesla, sorry, Jim, but the sort of autopilot on the Tesla is not something that you want your kid playing with.
Right.
Those are the features you don't want your 16-year-old playing with because they're cool. You want them to have those features that kick in when they don't know they're going to kick in, not something that's going to further distract them when they're driving.
I think might make a good future talking cars topic to talk about the cars that we thought were really cool when we were in high school, the cars we would have killed for. Anyhow, we'll have to work that out in the future. That's about all the time that we have for this episode. As always, check the show notes for more information on the vehicles and the topics we discussed. Just a reminder, please keep your questions coming to talkingcars@icloud.com. Thanks so much for tuning in. We'll see you next week.